Welcome everyone. In this video, we will learn how to design a quarter joint. So, first we will take a look at the different parts of quarter joint. This is very simple rod joint and there are mainly three parts. This part is called spigot and this is quarter. And number three, this part is called socket. Wireframe model of each part. Here we see that one of the rod has a socket end into which other rod is inserted, which is called spigot. There was a slot made in both socket and spigot end of the rod into which the quarter is inserted. Quarter is a flat wedge shaped piece of steel is used to connect rigidly two rods.
One thing we have to remember
that quarter joint is not used for connecting shaft that rotate and transmit torque. It is used when the shaft is subjected to tensile or compressive force. The quarter tapers along its width only in one side to insert oil and it is usually 1:24. Now we will learn the application of quarter joint. Quarter joint is used between the piston rod and the crosshead of a steam engine, slide spindle and the fork of the valve mechanism, tail or palm rod between the piston rod and the foundation bolt. Draw the front view and side view of the quarter joint and nomenclature it appropriately. The allowable stresses in tension is sigma t, compression is sigma c and shear is tau for socket, rod and quarter, and assuming that they are all made of same material. So first of all we calculate the tension failure of rod. Here we can see that the area is pi by 4 d square. D is the dia of each rod. So we can write here that pi by 4 d square into sigma t is equal to p, where the p is the acting tensile force on each rod and sigma t is equal to tensile stress. Number 2 is the tension failure of spigot across the slot. Here we see that the area is pi by 4 d1 square minus d1 into t. T is the thickness of the quarter and we know from the empirical relation t is the 0.31 d. So we can write here that pi by 4 into d1 square minus d1 into t into sigma t is equal to p, where sigma t is tensile stress. And from this equation we will get the d1, which is the dia of spigot end. Shown here how shear failure is done between quarter and socket due to tensile load P. Due to this action, we have to calculate the shear area both side of this part. Here we see that the shear area is L1 into D1 and for both sides it will be multiplied by 2. So the equation will be 2 into L1 into D1 into tau is equal to P, where tau is the shear stress and D1 is the dia of spigot part. From this equation we will get the distance L1 of spigot part. Due to tensile load P, there was a crushing failure between spigot and cotter in this area. And the crushing area is D1 into T, where T is the thickness of cotter and D1 is the dia of spigot.
So,
here we can write that D1 into T into sigma C is equal to P, where sigma C is crushing stress. And from this formula, we will get the thickness of cotter, which is T. Due to tensile load P, there may be shear failure between the two collars of socket and spigot in this area. And the area is pi D1 into T1. T1 is the thickness of spigot collar. So we can write here that pi into D1 into T1 into tau is equal to P, where tau is shear stress. So from this equation, we can calculate the T1, which is the thickness of spigot collar. For the tensile load P, there will be a crushing failure between two collar of socket and spigot, where D4 is the outer dia and D1 is the inner dia of spigot collar. We see here the crushing area will be pi by 4 d4 square minus pi by 4 d1 square. So we can write here that pi by 4 into d4 square minus d1 square into sigma c is equal to p, where sigma c is crushing stress, we also know. And from this equation, we can calculate the d4, the outer dia of spigot collar. Now we calculate the different type of failure of socket part. First of all, we calculate the tensile failure of socket across the slot. Here we see that D2 is the outer dia and D1 is the inner dia of socket part. And T is the thickness of cotter. So here we see that tensile cross sectional area will be pi by 4 into D2 square minus D1 square minus D2 minus D1 into T. So we can write here area into sigma T is equal to P, where sigma T is tensile stress. And from this equation, we will get the D2, which is the outer dia of socket end of the rod. Second is the shear failure of socket end. We see here, due to tensile load P, there will be a shear failure between cotter and socket end collar. So we have to calculate these two rectangular shaped shear area and back side of this part, that is total 4 shear area. Here we see that the shear area will be d3 minus d1 into L. And for the opposite side, it will be multiplied by 2, where dt is the dia of socket collar and L is the distance from end of slot to the end of socket. So we can write here that d3 minus d1 into 2L into tau is equal to P, where tau is the shear stress. and from empirical relation we also know that L is equal to L1 is equal to 0.75 d. so from this equation we can calculate the dt, the dia of outer dia of socket collar. Number 3 is crushing failure of socket collar. For the tensile load P, there will be a crushing failure by the cutter on the socket collar end. And here we see that the crushing area is dt minus d1 into t, where dt is outer and d1 is the inner dia of socket collar and t is the thickness of cutter. So we can write here that dt minus d1 into t into sigma c is equal to P, where sigma c is crushing stress. And from this equation we can check the limit of crushing stress. Now we will calculate the different types of failure of cutter due to tensile load P. First of all, we calculate the shear failure of cutter due to tensile load P acting on the rigot and socket part. Here we see that tensile load will be half for the socket part. And for shear failure, we have to calculate this two shear area. And the shear area will be 2 into B into T, where B is the minimum width of cutter. So we can write here that 2 into B into T into tau is equal to P, where tau is the shear stress. And from this equation we can calculate the B, which is the minimum width of the cutter. And finally we will calculate the bending failure of cutter. I have drawn it horizontally because I treat this cutter as a simple supported beam. This middle portion of cutter present in the spigot is D1, because D1 is the dia of spigot. And from the center line, this distance is divided by 2, that means d1 by 2. And here we see that the maximum length of cutter present in the socket part is d3, that is the dia of socket collar. So this distance will be d3 minus d1 by 2. Now we will discuss about the force section on the cutter. Here we see that the middle portion of the cutter is subjected to the force P for the spigot part, and for the socket part the cutter is exerted, the force will be half, that means P by 2 and P by 2 for the top region and for the bottom region of socket collar. Now we will draw to represent this force section on the cutter. Here we have to assume that the force exerted by the spigot on this cutter is UDL, that means uniform distributed load. And now again we have to assume that the force exerted by the socket collar on this cutter is UVL, that means uniform varying load. We discussed previously that magnitude of UVL is P by 2 for spigot part, and for socket part the magnitude of UDL is P. But we know that from symmetry of forces that if the effective length is divided by center line, then the magnitude of single UDL is also divided by 2 halves, that means P by 2 and P by 2. Then we convert this single UDL into point load, and its base d1 by 2 is also divided by 2. That means the distance from center line of this point load will be d1 by 4. Now we convert the single UVL, that means uniformly varying load, into point load P by 2. And as we know that this UVL is at a distance of 1/3 of its base from the maximum intensity, and we also know that its base is d3 minus d1 by 2. So this point load will act at a distance d3 minus d1 by 2 into 1 by 3 from the maximum intensity. So finally this distance will be d3 minus d1 by 6. As we treat this quarter as a simply supported beam, so the maximum bending moment will be at the center of its effective length. Here we name this center point as O. Now we will find out the maximum bending moment. So it is denoted by MB. First of all, we consider this UVL load, which is right side from the center point O. The bending moment of this point load P by 2 with respect to this point O will be anticlockwise, and as we consider the anticlockwise bending moment is positive, so force is P by 2 and distance is OA. That means d3 minus d1 by 6 plus d1 by 2. Now we will consider this second UDL load P by 2 according to the point O. The bending moment of this load will be clockwise, that means negative. So it will be minus P by 2, and this distance OB is 1/4 of D1. If we simplify this equation, it will be D3 by 6 plus D1 by 12 into P by 2. So the maximum bending moment will be D3 by 6 plus D1 by 12 into P by 2. Now we will find out the bending stress, which is denoted by sigma b, and the equation is sigma b is equal to mb by I into y, where mb is the maximum bending moment and I is moment of inertia. Let us consider the cross section of a quarter having mean width is b and thickness is t. So moment of inertia I will be tb cube by 12, and y will be b by 2. Now we will put all the value. So the equation will be p by 2 within bracket d3 by 6 plus d1 by 12 by tb cube by 12 into b by 2. After simplification, the equation will be 3p within bracket d3 by 6 plus d1 by 12 by tb square. From this equation we will get the value of b, and previously we get the value of b from shear condition. B is equal to p by 2t by tau. From these two formula we have select the value of with b, whichever is the maximum between these two value. Once again, we'll see the empirical relation of quarter joint.